So we just heard from folks who started from within a bigger company or a station, and now these folks are the folks we're calling the independents, people who launched independently, even though they may be part of a bigger podcasting network now. And again, I just want to start off by letting you listen to their voices on the air.
So, like, what, was she hanging out at home in pajamas or what?
No, she was naked.
You were sitting with your kid at home, just like, so you were in your clothes and she was just sitting there naked for a month.
Yeah.
I cannot stand boys. I really get so annoyed by these men who act like their job is to coach women into being what they want to be. I think that's really what gets on my damn nerves.
This is Scantron with episode 155.
If he had gone the official route with the cops, he says it would have been a real pain.
And then I'd have been up for another 2 hours, you know, filling out reports with him.
But even this guy, the most patient live and let live guy in the neighborhood, eventually hit his limit.
Welcome to the heart. All the things that you feel but don't know how to name.
Hey, are you awake?
Don't know how to put into words. This is a show about all those things. Like...
All right. So that was Hillary Frank, Crissle West, Lynn Casper, Lauren Spohrer, and Kaitlin Prest. Well, it was actually Phoebe. It was Phoebe Judge.
She's at work.
So I want to start off with your origin stories too, because I feel like they're going to be a little different than what we just heard. And Crissle, I want to know a little bit about how you and your co-host decided to launch The Read and how it's evolved over the last 2 years. You really quickly got to 115,000 subscribers. So talk to me a little bit about how you did that.
Okay. Well, actually, the producer approached my co-host, Kid Fury, initially because he had appeared on a podcast that was on his network. And so he knew that Kid Fury had a huge YouTube following. He had a very successful pop culture blog. So he approached him about doing a podcast, and he said, well, only if I can do it with my friend. So he asked me to do it, and honestly, my first thought was, but black people don't listen to podcasts. Because, you know, 2.5 years ago, black people didn't. Nobody I knew listened to podcasts, and the only podcast I'd ever heard of was This American Life. So I just thought, I mean, that's fine, you know, we can go in the studio and do it. He said, you know, we only have to do one episode. If you think it's stupid, we just won't do it anymore. So we went in the studio and talked. We actually ranted for about an hour and 15 minutes about how much we hated New York, which was edited out, thankfully. And then we started talking about just what we had seen on TV that day, and the show just kind of evolved into the three-section format that it has now, just very organically. It just sort of happened, and the listenership happened the same way. It was really word of mouth. People who loved it were telling their friends, and for a long time, I was in denial that anyone was listening at all. So it took probably 6 months or so for me to even acknowledge that people were actually listening to the show, because it just seemed so foreign to me.
And you said, like, black people don't listen to podcasts. What changed?
Well, over the last year or so, there has been such a huge growth of black and other minority podcasts that have come out, which is fantastic, because now there are other places to point to when people say, well, you know, what else is out there? Because when we started, I think maybe Aisha Tyler had a podcast, Combat Jack, who is also on the network with us, had a successful hip-hop podcast. But other than that, there just wasn't a lot that was out there. So really, it's been over the last year or so that the growth has just been amazing, and now there's a huge variety of shows from which to choose, and a lot of them are black women and black queer individuals. So the diversity that's out there and that continues to come in is fantastic.
Do you think about joining a larger network, or do you think your voice is sort of preserved by being independent?
Well, our network is growing. We're adding new shows all the time. So I don't think it's anything about joining the larger network. What we bring in is really up to us, how many shows we do. You know, we have complete creative control over the show. We own the show. We're paid for everything that we do. We are... it's we're not going into this, you know, blindly or, you know, like we don't have, like we're not aware of our worth. We're very much, you know, aware of who we are and how unique our voices are, and we recognize ourselves. And so I don't think we're, it's nothing about, you know, being interested in going elsewhere.
Yeah. Yeah. So Hillary, you launched independently and then you joined WNYC to kind of help with production and marketing. And I'm wondering what the advantages were of launching independently for you.
Wow. Well, it's not something I thought about that much. there weren't really any other options at the time. I launched at the end of 2010. And I did it because I had had a baby like 10 months before that. And had been a freelancer. At this point, I've been a freelancer for 16 years. And so I was just trying to keep my foot in the door. You know, the radio landscape was changing, and I didn't know. I knew I wanted to go back to work in some way at some point, but I didn't know how. And so I knew that you could make a podcast out of your home, and you didn't. And it was really easy. So I started calling people during my daughter's naps. She would nap for like 20 minutes at a time. If I was lucky, 40 minutes. And I would call other moms during their, we would like coordinate, my kid's gonna be napping at this time, mine's gonna, and then we'd be like on the phone, she's down, okay, let's start. And like within 20 minutes, almost always they'd be crying. Like it was strangers, you know, to me. And it was incredible. And I only put the podcast out whenever I felt like it, whenever I felt like I could. And so that meant I made 20 episodes over 3 years, which is not very much by podcasting standards, and not what anyone would advise you to do. But I that's what I did. And then at some point, I was making money in other ways, and I had to decide whether basically I was going to do the podcast full time or I was going to do something else, which I thought was going to be tutoring college applicants on their essays, which I actually really loved doing it. I love teaching. And I thought, well, I'll give the podcast one last shot. I'll do a Kickstarter. And I did the Kickstarter, and it was more successful than people predicted. And I made $10,000 over my goal, and it caught the attention of Dean Capello here. And so the advantage of starting on my own was that I could prove that I could do this on my own if I wanted to. And so WNYC had to present a deal to me that would be more advantageous to me to be here.
What made it more advantageous?
Well, having the support, I mean, the biggest thing is I have a wonderful producer here, Joanna Solitaroff. She's sitting right there. And I would not have been able to afford to hire somebody. I get all of the benefits that other people have of working here, like a marketing team and events support and PR.
Has it changed
support.
The show at all?
Has it changed the show? Yeah, I mean, you know, it's really lonely to sit in a room by yourself and and put something together and like go over in your head, is this the right way to do it? Is that the right way to do it? Now I can pick up the phone and say, Joanna, do you think this is the right way to do it? Or do you have some better ideas? And so the show has changed in that, I mean, yeah, we talk to a whole lots more different kinds of people than including, you know, childless men, and have expanded it. When I started it, I thought it was going to be for 0 to 3 months. That's how limited I thought the longest, shortest time was, just the first 3 months of parenthood, and I wasn't in it anymore, and it didn't apply to me. And then I was like, oh no, now I think it should be about the first 6 months. And then it became the first year, 2 years, 3 years. By the time I got here, I was up to 3 years. And then when I got Joanna on board, I was like, I'm thinking about making it just about family life in general. And she was like, yeah, so that's what it is.
That's
now.
That's very funny. So Lynn, your podcast, Homoground, it's a little different because it's about music. And I'm wondering how you got started and grew your audience.
Yeah, actually someone posted on their Facebook page this quote that I feel is really fitting. And it said, be the person you needed when you were a teenager. And pretty much my podcast started way back when I used to make like mixtapes and took my dad's cassette tapes and would like pretend I was a radio DJ and just doing all these things when I was little. And growing up in North Carolina, as a queer kid who I'm half Filipina, I kind of always felt a little different and out of place. I was always just kind of searching for people that were similar-minded or people I could relate to. So I guess Homoground is basically the thing that I wish I could have found when I was a teenager. Just finding access to musicians who are speaking about experiences that, you know, queer kids can relate to. Not having access to see these bands in certain areas of the country. I just started playing music that my friends were making at the time, and they would tell their friends, and all of a sudden I just started getting these submissions from people, and I was like, okay, I guess I'm gonna keep playing people's music. And so I started doing the podcast Homoground in 2011, and it's been 4.5 years later, and it's been really awesome. Lots of submissions from people all over the world now.
Do you feel like you're sort of meeting that bar of reaching the kid you were when you were a teenager?
Yeah, I think so. And a lot of people, a lot of musicians will email us, or people who just live in areas where they can't go and see bands that they really like, send us messages that are really heartwarming and just like really speak to my teenage self. And I'm like, yes, this is my goal with this. So, yeah.
That's awesome. So, Lauren, you and Phoebe Judge launched Criminal a year ago, totally independently.
Yeah, it was
a year
January
and a half.
2014 was our first episode.
And originally it was once a month-ish?
Once a month, yeah.
And really quickly ramped up.
We're at every 3 weeks now, which feels like the most we can do. But we're hoping soon to go bi-weekly. So we're starting to work on that.
Talk a little bit about how the success of Serial impacted you guys. You're also true crime. Everyone here has talked about how Serial impacted everyone.
Yeah.
Rising tide raises all ships. But you guys in particular, did it have a specifically?
I think so. I mean, like, one, we get asked this all the time. I think the one thing I can really point to, though, is Julia Furlan put us on a list, a BuzzFeed list. Like, if you, like, Serial, try this. And we were right there. And that was, like, the single biggest day that that happened for us. So that was really awesome. So that was huge, and that was something concrete. But otherwise, yeah, I mean, I feel like it's just, it definitely, I think, just exposed more people to podcasts, and then more listeners came.
So how did you end up joining Radiotopia earlier this year?
We had been making Criminal for about 9 months, and just doing it ourselves, like paying for it out of pocket, recording at home. And then they just called and they were like, we're gonna do this Kickstarter, and if we meet our goal, one of the stretch goals could be to bring you guys on. And we had a few phone calls and we were just like completely elated. It was really, really exciting. Especially, you know, we live in North Carolina, it can feel isolating. So I think to feel like people are hearing the show, they're liking what we do, it was really, really awesome.
That's great. So Kaitlin, I was listening to a recent episode of The Heart, and I loved hearing how excited you and Mitra were about joining Radiotopia. You were like, we're going on a business trip. But of course, like for you guys, that meant like you were going on a business trip to Canada to visit a guy who is like a submissive living with a couple, transgender. It was, and it was still very moving and emotional. So I guess I'm wondering how has it changed what you can do with the show being part of a larger network?
That's a good question. I mean, this, like, the story of The Heart is like the story of the college radio show that you just couldn't let go of, you know? Like, we started out as Audio Smut on CKUT in Montreal, actually on the radio, you could believe it, at 6 p.m. All that sex.
6 p.m.?
Yeah. We never got a call. It, like, no, only once did we get a call in studio complaining, and it was like a hardcore feminist, like, being pissed off about the way we had represented somebody in the last story or whatever. Anyway, yeah, I mean, it's been a long journey. Like, I guess there was about 4 years. Okay, chapter one, CKUT. Chapter two, really believing that this idea, we had this naivety that I think carried us forward, that like radio is 24/7, and why wouldn't somebody want to put this on the radio? Like, it just didn't make sense to me. So we started knocking on doors, and everybody would say no, like, automatically. It just, like, the name itself was a little bit too much.
Audio is that smart. Why you changed the name?
Yeah. Yes. That is the reason. Because we love that name. But, okay, the question. I'm going to answer your question. How has being on Radiotopia changed things for us? I think that for a long time, we were struggling for a sense of legitimacy. Because making a radio show that's like about sex, and not just about sex, like let's have a conversation, but let's accurately represent sex by recreating the experience of sex in audio form. From a critical perspective. And when I say critical perspective, I mean like perspectives that we don't often hear and that people in positions of power don't relate to. So it was really, really hard for people to take us seriously. I mean, like, I would go to conferences and have people say, "So you make audio porn? Great! Can't wait to listen!" And I'm like, no, that's not what it is, you know? Like. And also just, you know, like writing grants, like trying to do the hustle of producing a show and trying to get money for the people who work on it so that they can like have a part-time job instead of a full-time job while doing this other full-time job on the side.
Talk to me a little bit about the hustle, because I feel like there are a bunch of people here who have questions about that, like right. How to get the support they need to...
That's it. I mean, so being on a college radio show is great, but we ultimately sort of severed our ties with the station so that we could pursue grant funding, because in a community station setup, any money that you get, you have to share with the station or just fork it all over, and we're like, no. And then we started trying to apply for grants and trying to figure out how to... I think the grant game is like trying... people have told me that it's like getting married. Like, you have to find somebody who is a good partner and who is aligned with your goals as a project. And unfortunately, most big foundations don't actually... support media production or art, like unless it's an art organization. So we had a hard time. We would go to feminist foundations, but they only support like direct activism. And then the journalism foundations are like sort of afraid of a radical feminist show that's about sex called Audio Smut. So that was hard. And then I mean, really, what it came down to, what it always comes down to, unfortunately, is like. Well, fortunately or unfortunately, is audience. I mean, like, I think for us, we were, like, really excited about the content, and we had this idea about public radio that, like, you know, I remember I went to PRPD to, like, you know, pitch my show, and, like, my approach, I was like, I'm going to be that artsy chick that they're all, like, excited to talk to, and I knew immediately that I had the wrong approach when I walked in. It was, like, a sea of beige, and I'm wearing my polka dot skirt, and I'm like, oh, my God, this is not going to go well, and it didn't. It really didn't. Like, you know, nobody cared about the content. Nobody cared about the concept. Nobody cared about, like, oh, these are voices that you don't hear on the radio. I was so surprised by that, because I so believed in public radio, you know, like, it was about how many listeners do you have? How many listeners do you have? Are you regular? You know, like, how consistent are you putting out the show? And to be honest, like, nothing changed for us until our audience grew.
What was the number you had to hit? I mean, I guess I'd like each of you to kind of answer that, like, what number you're at or what number you had to hit to get there?
For us, it was like we went from, we hit like 20, 25 per episode, and that happened because we did a piece on Snap Judgment, and our audience, like, that, I think that's
and that changed things.
That's a huge factor. I think, like, getting on a big show, a radio show with a big audience, like This American Life, Radio Lab, or, I mean, Snap was a fun surprise that it boosted that much. But that's when people started to say yes to, do you want to have a meeting? Which I had been asking for years. And like when I said that our audience has grown, like that changed things.
Lauren, yeah. Was there a moment like that
for
you guys?
No, I'm trying to remember. Yeah. I know that things have picked up a lot for us since joining Radiotopia. I remember we had 52 on our second episode. And now we have like over 1 million a month. So I feel like it's been like kind of a Whoa. Like if you look, it's like super, like it's like a total.
Were there moments where you're like, oh, we bumped?
The BuzzFeed thing was a big moment. Like Roman Mars mentioned us once on 99% Invisible. That was like a huge bump. But no, we haven't like been on any shows or anything like that. So it's been like pretty just like regular, slow and steady.
Got it. Do you have a moment where things like sort of shifted suddenly?
It has been pretty steady over the past couple of years. But being independent, we've kind of can dictate how often we release episodes. But this past fall, I added a co-host. So we've been a little bit more consistent, and just being more consistent, we've definitely seen a rise. So I think just kind of making sure we put out episodes on a regular basis has really helped.
What about you? Was there a time it pumped?
Well, I think we were fortunate to come in at a time when, there wasn't a lot out as far as like Black, gay, pop culture at all. And so we were fortunate enough to receive a lot of media attention that I don't think a lot of newer podcasts are kind of as accessible to. So we ended up being in like the Washington Post and getting big interviews with Slate and being on Cracked and stuff like that. Stuff that put us out to a way bigger audience than what we would have thought of previously, but still it's always been word of mouth and people being like really passionate about the show and energetically sharing it with their friends that has consistently provided the most growth.
And Hillary, I know you guys were recently on This American Life. I wonder, did you see anything from
that? Oh yeah, like we tripled our audience.
Whoa.
Also the podcast, it wasn't necessarily the radio play. But we saw a bump previous to that, which was because we did a sex series, and it was four parts, and it ended with the This American Life story. So we had seen a bump at the beginning of that a couple months before, and I also have to say that we get our best performing episodes are often the ones featuring women of color, and we pride ourselves on having a diverse representation on the podcast.
That's interesting. So I guess I'm wondering, a bunch of you have done live shows or live events, and how that sort of influences your listenership, why you feel it's important, anything these ladies need to know about doing live events. I think almost all of you have done them. And what's the secret sauce behind live events? And I know you're about to have one in Brooklyn.
Yeah,
right?
We're having one July 15th. Please come. We did one in Durham, North Carolina, where we live. And it was great. I mean, it was just super, we were so shocked by the turnout, and it was just like so gratifying to like talk to people before and afterwards and just to like hear people reacting. And it was really fun for me, because I've been working with Phoebe for a long time, long before we started Criminal. And it was so much fun just to watch her sort of like hosting live, right? And narrating live, and just the whole energy was completely different. A live interview is always awesome. I don't know, it's like, it's just, it sort of like refreshes you in a strange way. I will say though, it is so much work to get ready for it, and you don't make any money. Like, you like lose money. But it's good, because if you, like, this is a rather solitary enterprise, you're by yourself a lot, in your head a lot. So I think getting out there and interacting with people is really fun.
I would agree, I was about to say the same thing. I mean, like, for us, the intersection between, like, trying to bring radio as a sort of piece of culture out into the world where people can consume it in ways where it gets the respect that a film or a play or a band would get is something that we've really believed in since the beginning. Like, the live show has always been a part of our ethos as audio makers. But it's just re-energizing. Like, there's something like it's fun to connect with the community that listens to your show, but really it's like even more fun to have a room full of people clap at the end of what you did. It's just like, wow. And I mean, especially like when you're doing this kind of work, like every once in a while, like you get kind of like, oh God, like, am I gonna keep doing this? Like, can I keep doing this like full-time job on the side of my other full-time job? Like, and doing a live event, it just like so much energy, so fun.
How do your live events work? Talk a little bit about it.
Well, our first one was actually down at Le Poisson Rouge, not in the nice performance area, but like in the bar part in the back, that hallway right by the bathrooms. So it was super classy. We didn't even have enough chairs for the number of tickets we sold. It was by far our raggediest show, by far the worst one. But the energy in that room was something that I just had never, it just, that was when the show became real to me. Like, we had heard about numbers and advertisers and all that just seems still so foreign. But when we were in the room in front of these people who like had heard us and knew how we were, that was just, it was the most amazing moment. And since then we've definitely ironed out the kinks. We've, you know, started booking in actual auditoriums now so everyone gets the chance to sit down. And we've figured out that balance between, you know, being alone in the studio versus being in a room of 500 people. It's, you know, obviously we're going to have to adjust for the people in the audience. So definitely I think the best feedback that we've received from them is that they're able to catch the little things that audio doesn't catch when you can see people in person. Mm. So our facial expressions are very different when we're interacting with each other. Definitely when we're interacting with the audience, we look at people like, you know, they are ridiculous because they often are. Kiffier is known to fall out just on the floor in exhaustion. So it's that sort of energy and interacting with the people that makes the live show so much fun. So I actually have one in Chicago this weekend. And then we'll be in LA, back in New York. We're going to London in September, which is amazing. So just the chance to interact with the people is definitely the most rewarding part.
And your live shows are a little bit different. You do mom speed dating.
Yeah, so there's a couple things we've done. We were recently in San Francisco, and I interviewed Roman Mars live in Oakland. And that was amazing, because we're friends in real life. But I never asked him too many personal questions about his family life. And I got to do it live on stage, and that was really fun. And then we have this like signature event, which is called Speed Dating for Mom Friends, and it's what it sounds like. It's like, you know, it's really hard to make friends when you're a mom, and sometimes you lose all your old friends, or they just don't live near you. And so we take the guesswork out of it and do a whole like speed dating thing. And so we, it's a different kind of thing where it's not really radio, but we like to think of ourselves as like the place where people go to find other non-judgy parents where they can feel safe and have conversations. And so it's not just the podcast, it's like a whole brand thing. And so we see the speed dating for mom friends as a way to convey that and bring people together.
And Lynn, I know you guys have a live show coming up, right?
Yeah, so we put on shows, mostly music shows, with a lot of the bands that we featured on the podcast. We have a show this Sunday at Grand Victory in Brooklyn if you guys want to come, hang out, check out some new music. But other than that, we do a monthly open mic night down in Durham, North Carolina. And then we have a 90s queer party that we do every other month up here. But yeah, a lot of, in addition to like the events that we organize, one of my favorite things is to spotlight different festivals and upcoming events that are happening, and just give like a preview of the bands that are playing so people know what to expect, and just to help promote the bands and get their music out there.
I feel like you're all saying the community building is huge, basically, yeah, for you guys.
I think I forgot to say that it's also kind of like a fun creative project to sort of try to create in a real space the world of your show. Uh-huh. Like, that's something that we think about a lot. Like, our last event, which we've been taking on tour, was like basically a makeout party. And we had this kissing booth that was sort of the centerpiece of the evening, that was built by this woman that I met naked in the yoga change room. She like came up to me and she was like, "Do you have a podcast called The Heart?" And I was like, "Oh my God, I never thought this moment would happen, especially now." Naked in yoga. And she was a carpenter. And I was like, "I'm trying to build a kissing booth." And she's like, "I'm a carpenter." And I was like, "This is great."
You're like, "Let's get some clothes on and talk some more."
Yeah, right. But, you know, like just sort of like figuring out ways of, like what would The Heart look like in a room? You know, it turns out like, glittering tulle everywhere, you know, like those kinds of things are fun to think about. Just fun party things.
So I'm going to go to questions soon, because I just feel like people had so many questions about launching independently that you guys can address. But I do have a question for each of you, which is sort of a simple one, but what would you tell yourself if you were launching however many years ago you launched that you now know? Like, what is the thing you've learned that you would, like, tell yourself 5 years ago, 2 years ago, whenever you launched? Yeah, start.
Okay. I would say time is not really time. It's like, it's about motivation. I would tell myself, you know, being motivated and inspired to keep going is what will help you see past all of the obstacles that lie before you. You don't see the obstacles, you just see like this glorious future where you're making your radio show all the time or your podcast, sorry. Yeah, and that like having more time is not actually the thing. It's like being inspired, and so finding the people who inspire you and push you, who can, you know, who you want to impress, because you're working outside of an institution. You don't have a boss to tell you, you know, get here at 9. So sort of creating an institution among people who push you. That's what I think, you know, that's the most important thing that I think I've forgotten many times along the way.
I love that, because there always is not enough time, you know.
But yeah, but it doesn't matter, you know, because right. If you're motivated, it doesn't matter, you know, because yeah. You're like, I can do this in 5 minutes, I can do this in an hour, I'll make time. Anyway, yeah. What about you?
I think I'm going to echo what Anna Sale said about self-promotion. I think that it's something I really struggle with still. It's not my personality to toot my own horn, and it's certainly not Phoebe Judge's personality to toot her own horn. So we really struggle to be like, you know, check us out. Or, you know, like when we first started the show, we sent all these emails to like people. She and I both worked in public radio, so we sent emails to a lot of people in public radio we knew, and it was just like this sort of like mealy mouth, like, we are trying to make a podcast, please listen. And people were back and they were like, cool, and like nothing really happened. But I wish that I could go back in time and be sort of like more assertive about it. Like, we're experienced in this field and we have an idea and it's a good one and we're gonna work hard at it. And so I wish I could go back in time and sort of say that to myself, but that's something that we still struggle with now, you know, like, somebody just told me that you should be tweeting like 10 times a day, and I was like, no way, like, that's ridiculous, like, we're not going to tweet about criminal 10 times a day. So I think I'm still trying to teach myself that like self-promotion is not inherently disgusting, and that, you know, sometimes you write a tweet and someone replies and they're like, oh, thanks, like, I'd never heard of the show and now I have. So sometimes it's just like genuinely spreading the word, and I think you don't have to feel oily about it necessarily.
Yeah, I think in terms of kind of podcasting being like a little isolating at times, just reminding yourself that if you keep being consistent and keep pumping things out, if you're not seeing results right away, to not get discouraged, because it does take a lot of time to kind of build those things. And I mean, once people find it, then they have all of those past episodes that they can listen to. So if they're not listening right at the start when you're starting out, don't get discouraged. Just takes a lot of patience. I've definitely learned to just be patient.
I think I would tell myself that just being me is enough, and I don't have to stress out about whether people like me or not. I think the authenticity of the show is definitely what helped drive the growth that we experienced so rapidly, and it was easy to get caught up in, oh God, how should I change? Like, what should I do as the audience grows? You know, how should I change my voice to maybe make more people happy? But what I've learned over the past couple of years is that just being me is honestly the only way I can continue to go into the studio. If I go in the studio with someone else's desires or wants or anything else really in mind, then it's not going to be authentic and the show won't feel right to me. So I think definitely just reminding myself consistently, if I had known then that just being me was fine and I wouldn't have to stress out, then maybe you know, some of the points over the last couple of years would have been a little easier.
I think I would tell myself to take what people say about numbers with a grain of salt. Yes, you can't be making money on your podcast unless you hit a certain number of listeners, but you're not going to get there. And like, it's in my situation, it wasn't that I couldn't get support from an organization unless I hit those very high numbers. you know, this organization was able to see that with their help, I could reach those numbers. And so I think it's important to remember to make the best product you can and be very clear about who you're reaching and the power that you have over an audience that's more than just audio. That's like what is your show gonna do to make people change the way they see the world or each other? Like there's a huge power in that in audio, and we all know that. And so it's not just about numbers; it's about making the thing that will bring in the numbers.
Great. I think there's a question over here.
Yeah, I happen to have a microphone, which is handy. My name's Susie, I work at WNYC, and I'm wondering how you guys, if anybody will talk about how you, if you were independent, how were you paying for this without going broke? And when you merged with distributors or people that you kind of started this marriage with, did you get to own your intellectual property?
I guess I feel like I'm still broke. Like I don't know. I mean, it's radio. I hope this changes. Like I hope that this moment in radio is actually transforms audio into a legitimate form of entertainment that people are willing to throw down the cash for. I think that would be really great and exciting. I mean, I remember conversations that Mitra and I had where she'd be like, I need a full-time job. I can't pay my rent. And I'd be like, no, don't get a full-time job. It's going to ruin the show, you know? And I was lucky enough to get a job working sort of a part-time gig on another podcast called Life of the Law. And that allowed me, it was a magic accident. But I think that if you have your eyes on the prize enough, like you create the space that your life needs to keep making the work that you want to make. We had this, it was pretty scrappy. Like we would like trade tape syncs. We would write to people that we knew. We'd send things out on air being like, hey guys, like this is a passion project. If you do a tape sync for us in your obscure city, we'll do a tape sync for you in New York. We found weird ways of getting people to record themselves. Like we would send our recorder in the mail. We paid out of pocket, but most of the time we would figure out a way to do it for free. Not accounting for our time, like, you know, how much our time should cost. And then what was the other question? I mean, that's one of the most amazing things about Radiotopia. Like, Radiotopia we own it, and they also, it's in the contract, they exert no editorial control over what we do. Yeah.
With Criminal, we paid out of pocket. Although I think that you can do it for less than you think. Like, we paid out of pocket for everything, but we would mail recorders, we would just beg, like, people to go do tape syncs for us. Now there's this pretty good iPhone app called Ringer. I don't know if anyone's used it. Sounds pretty good. So if the person has an iPhone, we paid out of pocket, and then when we joined Radiotopia, like the first thing we did was pay ourselves back. But it really was like a lot less than you might think. I don't know.
Yeah, mine's paid by a day job and credit cards.
We started out thankfully because the network approached us. They paid for our time in the studio, and it took about 5 or 6 months for advertisers to start coming in. Pardon me. I guess that's totally different from some of the other experiences, but we do own the show completely, and no one else has any control over the content. It's literally whatever we want to talk about, 100%.
I paid for it by tutoring and freelance working on some other podcasts. I helped Jonathan Mitchell start The Truth and worked on another, so just odd jobs. Yeah.
Posey.
Hi, I'm Posey. I'm at KUOW. You guys are called the Independents, but I know that some of you, to differing degrees, work closely with other people. So I wonder if you can talk a little bit about, for those of you who do work closely with others, what are the advantages of that and what are the challenges?
When you say others, what do you mean? Like our own staff or outside our own staff?
People who feel a sense of ownership over the project and want to exert creative control.
Of some kind.
I own my project. I'm in partnership with WNYC. We co-own the content that I create with them. But I own the name, and I've no one's ever told me not to do anything, including a sex series. So, yeah, it feels totally like mine still.
I have a co-host, and we have a pop culture podcast, so we're not really ever at odds as to what to discuss. And also, we'll start off on one topic and then get derailed by the smallest thing and start talking about something else for the next 25 minutes. So it's really just the two of us in the studio talking to each other. It's not really anything where one of us is like, I want to talk about this, and the other one just refuses, unless it's like a controversial rapper or something along those lines.
Yeah, I mentioned earlier that I added a co-host in the fall, and his name is Jackson, and he came to me because he had heard of the podcast before a couple years ago and was a super big fan, and he used to do public radio and wanted to get back into it, so he was like, hey, do you need any help with anything? I was like, yeah, that'd be great. So it's been really helpful in just having someone to keep you motivated, someone to help out, because it can be a lot of work, so just someone to help kind of carry that with you.
I mean, you guys launched as three people, right?
Yeah, we launched with Eric Mennel. That's another reason maybe we could afford it. We were splitting the cost three ways, but we all had full-time jobs. Like, we did this at night. Yeah, so, and then Radiotopia doesn't exert any sort of editorial control, or, you know, I don't feel...
Do you each, like, sort of co-own it equally?
Well, Eric left. Eric moved to New York. He works for Gimlet now, and he works on Mystery Show, and... So now Phoebe and I have an LLC, and we own it 50-50.
This has been actually like a huge, Mitra and I, like, whose show is this? And I mean, we started out as a collective, which means that one person does all the work but doesn't have a title. Or, you know, sorry.
Sounds good.
But that was not in the Mitra days. Mitra came on, and we were like legitimately partnered on the show. But, you know, one person takes up more space and gets more attention and more credit. And it's strange because I think that in our world, we do have a tendency to sort of like associate, you know, it's like the face of the thing. It's like the lead singer of the band syndrome, you know, like lead singer of the band. And it's like, oh, like, I love your work. And it's like, well, this is a band and there's, you know, we all work here. So, you know, you're just the person at the front. And so Mitra and I, we had really long conversations about whether to partner on the business, because we formed an LLC, and we've had, you know, we did ultimately decide to partner. We're going to have a wedding in October, which is we're going to read our business agreement instead of our vows. You guys are invited. and I think we're going to make a radio piece actually about all of our sort of like really huge, big challenges in collaborating and sharing this work. And it's definitely a struggle. I want to give a good reason why, or like an example of something, without like being, I don't know, I feel like she should be here. But yeah, come to the wedding, you'll find out. That's, yeah.
I was just wondering, I'm not entirely clear, how many of you still have full-time jobs in addition to making the podcast? And is the goal to not be working another job? And what would it take for you to quit the other job and just totally do your podcast?
I quit my job 2 weeks ago.
Oh,
congratulations. Oh, thank you. So I mean, I was a very poorly paid adjunct, so it's like exciting, but it was easier for me to jump than for Phoebe. Phoebe works full-time at WUNC, the public radio station where we live, and so we don't know if she's going to be able to leave or when. I mean, one advantage is that we do live somewhere cheap, you know, so that helps us out a little bit.
My last day at work is tomorrow. I held on for as long as I possibly could, just because there's no such thing as too much money in New York City. But it's at the point where I honestly cannot juggle both, and it was starting to affect my performance at work, so I just gave notice, and I'm just going to be working for myself full time and praying that, you know, it works out. So fingers crossed.
I've been a freelancer since I graduated from college, and I this is my first stable job in my life. And yeah. I'm happy to have it.
I freelance part-time as a social media strategist, but I kind of like it, so right now it's good.
I, as I said, I work on another podcast that I helped sort of develop, Life of the Law, and I am still working there, and I feel like it would be great to just work on the heart, but there's also a tiny piece of me in that show as well. It would be hard to leave. I will probably stay connected somehow, but that's sort of where the money comes in, and then small things on the side. I mean, we've been actually, one thing I will say is that we've been getting paid quite well to take our live show on tour, like at universities and stuff like that. I would agree with you, you don't make money on ticket sales really, but like universities have the bucks. And also there's a lot more radio festivals popping up all over the world, and people have been reaching out to us and flying us out and paying us to do live shows at festivals. So that's awesome too. Yeah.
One more question.
I know that you, Kaitlin, have some advertisers that are just like small advertisers, and you, Crissle, mentioned that the advertisers started to come in like 5 months in. I'm curious, like, did you reach out to them? Did they reach out to you? Do they ever put pressure on you in terms of the work that you do creatively?
Not at all. I mean, our founding sponsor is Babeland. And they, that was an awesome thing that happened, because like we were super scared, like with people with public radio hearts, of going into this sort of commercial territory. Like I was really not comfortable with it. And finding a business that actually has some kind of social mission, they gave us way more money than market rate for our 5,000 audience per episode. Yeah, so that was sort of like a bond that happened early on. And they've never, yeah, now the advertisers that we get through Radiotopia that like have nothing to do with our content, like it's a very sort of like business transaction. Like there's no commenting. But I will say that the content that we make, I know the sponsorship lady at Radiotopia is like, it's hard to get people to advertise with explicit content. That's a real thing. But yeah.
Our producer has a relationship with the Midroll, which is an advertising company for a podcast. So once the numbers were there and what was considered successful 2 years ago or a little over 2 years ago is definitely not what is considered successful now. So I think if you're coming into podcasting with the goal of making money, you are gonna have a long road to hoe, because the market is just, it's way bigger now than what it was then. So I definitely feel like anyone who's getting into podcasting should be doing it because they really feel like genuinely passionate about whatever they're talking about. But yeah, so thankfully he had a relationship with them, and once the show started picking up, they started pitching advertisers to us, and we've had some companies that have stayed with us pretty much since the advertising began, and then we're picking up new stuff all the time. At this point, they just pitch us the people who are interested in advertising on the show, and we decide whether we're into the product or not, and then we get people who come straight through email and say, hey, I'm interested in advertising on the read, and then our producer will set that up with them independently. But so it's a mixture of both.
When I joined WNYC, they took over my underwriting, and because it's public radio, there's a pretty heavy divide between content makers and the people who bring in the money. So I don't have anything to do with that anymore, really. But when I was doing my Kickstarter, part of what made it so successful was I had a very small audience, but I was convinced that I could find funders who would back me because of the content. And so I cold called a bunch of different brands that I felt had supported me in early motherhood. And I thought, well, what I'm selling is my voice and my ability to tell a story. And so I called up like three or four brands that I felt a connection to, and I left messages for their marketing managers, and all of them said, we've never done anything like this before, but yes. And they gave me small amounts of money. I think they each gave me, it was like between $1,200 and $5,000. And and they would be like challenge grants. So it would take a while to get up to, say, the first 5,000, and then suddenly I'd be at 10,000, you know? So, some of those companies would say, like, Music Together said, we'll back you on one episode if it's about music. And I said, okay, I'll make it about music, but you have no editorial input at all. You hear it the first time when it goes on the podcast. And so that worked out for that, like, distinct amount of time.
You guys? We've just started really getting into advertising. And a few times people have emailed us, which has been really nice, because I feel like when we do reach out to people, sometimes it's a little frustrating because you just never hear back from them. But yeah, that's definitely something we're trying to explore a little bit more, and I'd like to talk to a lot of the panelists about it.
We didn't try to get any advertisers or anything, so since that's a new thing since joining Radiotopia, and then they take care of it. There's this great lady, Kathleen, who takes care of that. And then she'll come to you and she'll say, like, do you want to do this one? And sometimes we say no. Like, but yeah, it feels pretty separate.
You guys did get a little bit of foundation money, I saw, from Sloan at some point. So I guess I'm wondering how, as a small podcast, you go to a big foundation like Sloan and start that.
What do you mean? Like, Radiotopia got the...
No, I thought you guys did.
No.
Oh.
We had a STEM grant to do one science story last year. But no, we haven't gotten any funding or anything beyond Radiotopia.
Okay. Guys, that's it. It's time for lunch.